It's an age-old debate, Aaron. Conventional versus synthetic engine oil.
Well, is it really worth it to use full synthetic over conventional?
I can only think of two brands that even make a full synthetic. You got Yamaha with their 530, and Mercury just came out with the 1030 with the V12.
True, true. Suzuki, they make a full synthetic, but it's only for their motorcycle stuff. So they've only got their semi-synthetic.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they use that 1040 semi-synthetic on pretty much all their outboards, right?
Yeah, like V7000 or something. And then Honda, I don't even know if they make a synthetic blend. I think it's only conventional.
See, I find that interesting that there's companies that still use only conventional, you know, and knowing what you know about the differences between the two.
Mm-hmm. With nothing, like not even an option of a semi-synthetic.
Yeah, with Suzuki, I guess you're just... Suzuki, if you own a Suzuki, it's the simplest answer. You're using 1040 semi every time. It doesn't matter whether you prefer conventional or synthetic or not.
Mm-hmm. It's also funny that when you look stuff up, like when you're looking at the different engines, pretty much all of them you could use either conventional or a semi. I don't know if there are some engines that don't want you to use a full synthetic, but I can't think of one that like puts that in writing and says that you can't use a full synthetic.
Yeah, there's, I mean, actually in writing, a lot of the engines will pretty much just tell you to put oil in it. they're like, well, we recommend using this, but if you don't have this, you can use this. And if you don't have that, oil, then just put something similar in there from another brand. But I think it does have to follow some kind of certification or something, right, at least.
Oh, yeah. Well, all the... So there's the big difference between your car and the outboard, or any boat motor for that matter, boat engine, whatever you want to say. There's a certain rating, which is the FCW, which is four cycle water cooled engine, gasoline engine. And those have a different rating altogether, just based on the minerals and properties and stuff that they put in the oil. Because, you know, when you're running your engine, it's like 5,000-6,000 RPM, whereas your
marine
car
engines are, or marine engine oil is designed to handle, I wouldn't say necessarily higher temperatures, I guess, but definitely higher RPM range. And
the marine is definitely for higher RPM, not really higher temperature, because your oil at that high RPM is still going to be around like 210 or stuff like that.
Mm-hmm. I think marine fuel or marine oil also has better anti-corrosive properties.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
Got different additives for that kind of deal, too.
Absolutely.
Which makes sense. Something about how it reacts with water. I thought I read something about that, but I'm not too sure.
Well, just being in the super moist environment of, you know, running a gasoline engine on the water.
Yeah, exactly. So I guess that is the most important thing, is no matter what oil you're using, make sure it's got that
rating.
MMA FCW rating.
Mm-hmm.
That way we know it's marine engine oil.
Yeah.
Right. Now the weight.
Yeah. Now that's the important part. I think that most manufacturers are really pretty like specific on the weight that they want to use in their engine.
Right. Which makes sense. You know, that's been known as old as forever. I mean, you look on your oil fill cap in a car and it tells you what oil you should use.
Mm-hmm.
But really, how important is that? Because they do just say, if you don't have this, use this. If you don't have this, use this.
I think different models have different like specifics to them. So like most of the Yamahas, they're pretty, you know, they say basically put oil in that thing and this is going to be all right. They want you to use a specific weight, but there are other ones. Like I think like Suzuki, they want that. What is it?
1040.
Yeah.
1040 on everything.
Now, what's really the difference in conventional versus your semi-blend versus your full synthetic?
Well, like pretty much conventional is just like raw oil that's been through like minor refining processes, I guess. And it's got a bunch of inconsistently sized particles and just a minor additive package.
So with those different particle sizes, that means that it's just going to basically give different lubrication at different points. So you don't have an even lubrication of the internal parts of the engine.
Right. And that's where synthetic, you know, it's all man-made in a lab. So all the particles are, you know, I don't want to say all the same size, but around the same size, they're all more refined particles and it provides a more even lubrication in the cylinder and just everything working there. Synthetics also handle higher or just extreme temperatures better, whether mm-hmm. it be really hot or really cold. It handles the breakdown a lot better in that temperature range.
Right.
It just, you know, on paper and you know, there's plenty of videos out there comparing them. Synthetic oil is better oil.
Right.
I guess the only thing, there is that myth with, or I'm not sure if it is a myth or not. I guess I haven't put it to the test myself, but if you use synthetic oil on an older engine that might already have a leak, then mm-hmm. it'll make that leak worse because it is so refined.
Right. It's
like thinner and it'll seep out of a bad gasket.
Right. Or a worn gasket.
Yeah. But really the answer isn't just throw conventional oil in it to slow the leak down, fix the leak. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But, you know, if you can afford to always use synthetic oil, which, you know, if you've got an outboard, chances are you probably can. Synthetic oil is better oil for your outboard.
Well, didn't you say something about reading something where they said somewhere that a semi-synthetic oil is only like up to 30% synthetic and then 70% conventional?
There's all kinds of different numbers on that, but they say around 20 to like 50% at most is really what you see. Yeah, there's all kinds of different answers. There's no solid answer as to how much synthetic blend or synthetic oil is in the synthetic blend.
Right.
But really, I can't remember for Mercury's using anything other than synthetic blend. Synthetic blend just seemed like...
Yeah, I don't think they make stable. A conventional, do they?
They do.
They do?
Mercury makes conventional for everything, which I didn't know up until a few weeks ago, actually, when I first saw the Quicksilver bottle. And I was like, man, that one's got a blue label on it, not a silver mm-hmm. one. It looks different. I don't know they made conventional oil. We've just always put that semi-synthetic stuff in every single
right
L6 we've serviced.
I was just trying to think if they, I guess they do. I mean, in the outboard world, we don't really use that much as far as the conventional. So I knew they used to make it, but I didn't know that they, because they just came out with a full-blown full synthetic for that V12, V10, or no.
No, not the V12.
Is got the full synthetic, and the V10 uses the 2540, 2550, right?
Yeah. Yeah. Interestingly enough, I think everything in the Mercury product line, mm-hmm. like it says everything up to 150 and then the 3.4 and 4.6 liters, which is every motor in the line besides the V10
right.
and the V12
yeah.
used 1030.
Yep.
So then you got the V10 being thrown in using the same as what the L6 used to use, and it's kind of weird. I guess spices
it up a little bit.
Yeah, it up a bit.
It's almost like they're following Suzuki, like to a point where, like, you know, since they only use one weight of oil, it's kind of mm-hmm. like simple. But they only make up to that 350. So
yeah, I don't know. I found it weird seeing that Mercury still has that 2540 for the V10, but they don't even make the 2540. Or 2550 in a full synthetic.
No, it's only that one. Neither does Yamaha. Yamaha's full synthetic is, I think, 530.
Mm-hmm.
And that one like is mainly for like the VMAX, stuff like that. It's got the gold bottle.
Yeah, I don't think I've ever even seen it.
But
Yamaha oil jugs just look like old two-stroke jugs.
Well, that oil, their 1030 and 2040 is a conventional.
It is, right? Yeah.
Yeah.
Does Yamaha make even a semi-synthetic? I don't think I've ever seen it on the bottle, and I'm pretty sure you got to advertise it if it is, right? I mean, you'd want
yeah.
to.
Yeah, you'd want to.
If it doesn't say anything about synthetic anywhere, it's got to be conventional.
I don't think they do. I mean, from what I saw, it's, you know, the blue 1030, 2040 is all conventional, and the gold 530 is full synthetic.
Mm-hmm.
So... And they say that you can put that 530 in, I'm pretty sure, every single one of those engines. So
right. But Yamaha lists it out a little differently. They have like a grade 1 and grade 2.
Right, right, like yeah.
Grade 1 is the recommended oil for this outboard. And it'd be, you know, 1030, 1040, 530. Mm-hmm. And grade 2 is like, if you don't have that, you can use. And then they list off every other oil they have.
Yeah.
It's like...
Yeah. It's pretty interesting. Like I said, I mean, they pretty much say... stick oil in this thing and you're going to be all right.
I don't know. I guess maybe it just has to do with because of how often you're supposed to be servicing these things mm-hmm. and how often you're supposed to be changing that oil. Maybe it's not the biggest thing in the world because with cars, you start getting into mileage instead of time.
Yep.
And, you know, nobody ever, I don't even think I've ever heard of a time interval for a car's oil change, right? It's always change it every 3,000 miles or something.
It's always mileage, which is weird because, I mean, the oil is going to break down over time too. So like oil that sits, mm-hmm. it does, you know, I don't know if you would call it a phase separation or just like a, I don't know what you would call it, some sort of like molecular breakdown of the chemistry of the oil. But like Honda, theirs is all conventional. And I think we saw something about like using conventional oil to break in an engine and then using the synthetic after that. Now, are there some benefits to that, you think?
I'm not really sure. I would think that synthetic is just better overall. I mean,
mm-hmm. Yeah,
the science backs it. You know what I mean? It shows the only time I wouldn't use synthetic, I guess, is if you've got an old outboard that may or may not have some bad gaskets that have a leak. But
they make such thick oil already in a semi blend. I mean, 2550 is a thick oil.
Yeah, that's right. 50 is a heavy oil.
So, I mean, what's going to be the difference?
Yeah. I don't know. I'd say, I guess it doesn't really matter all that much. You just use the manufacturer recommendation, which is pretty broad.
Yeah.
Well, for most of them, because mercury at least gives you, for most of them, one. Mm-hmm. Like you should use this.
Right.
But then again, they don't specify on any of them except the V12. What they recommend as far as conventional or synthetic blend.
Right.
Because the V12, they'll tell you, they recommend using that 1030 full synthetic.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. If you can't use any other 1030.
Right.
But for every other one, they're like, you know, for the V10, use 2540 synthetic blend or conventional. Doesn't matter. All depends on your wallet, how much you want to spend.
Well, I'm with you on that because, I look at it like I would want to put whatever the manufacturer's oil is. So mm-hmm. like, you know, I'm going to look at, if I got a Honda, I'm going to run the Honda oil. If I got a Suzuki, I'm going to run the V7000 oil because that's, you know, their brand. Same thing for the Yamaha. I'm going to use their brand oil. And that's just kind of the way I am. I guess I've never really thought about, from what I've seen going and buying, like you go to West Marine, you go to Bass Pro. I mean, most of the oils are pretty similar. I mean, you might save $10 a gallon or something like that, but it's not like a massive, it ain't like $100 difference.
Yeah. I think the biggest difference is like with conventional 1030 versus the full synthetic is like $30 a difference. But I wouldn't use the conventional on any of them anyway. You know, I'd use the synthetic blend. And then if you wanted to spend the extra $10 for the full synthetic from the synthetic blend, then
mm-hmm.
then why not? You know, full synthetic is better.
Yeah.
That's what they say.
And you're using it, like you said, it's on a time frame. It's mm-hmm. not on like a mileage. It's not a distance thing. So
there's probably a spec for cars in time. There has to be. Like if you don't hit this mileage, you're supposed to change it at,
I think, like, it's once a year.
That would make sense, but
yeah,
it's not, you don't hear that like you do with an outboard.
I mean, I think you do, don't you? I mean, I was always, for everything I've ever seen, I've always seen 1 year or like your mileage. Oh, so, okay. I mean, I don't know, maybe I never really looked too far into it, but from my understanding, every car that I've ever dealt with, I've always just been once a year change oil. I mean, on my truck, I don't even put that many miles on it, especially when I lived in Maryland, and I would change oil twice a year.
Mm-hmm. Honestly, I don't think synthetic. I think unless they tell you, like that V12 Mercury or the V-Maxes, unless they tell you to use synthetic, I don't see it being that necessary. Mm-hmm. You know, not saying to cheap out. You know, if you want to buy the synthetic, I don't think it's going to hurt the engine. And, it's probably going to do.
I think it's going to lubricate better.
Mm-hmm. But think about how many Yamahas you've seen with a million hours that you use nothing but conventional.
That's like, a very good point, like, because
does it really matter if I use synthetic? Like, this outboard's still going to last me
a
long time.
Like we were talking about last video about how many hours were on the outboard and what's, you know, too many.
Mm-hmm.
We've had countless Suzuki, Yamaha, Mercury. Like we've had all of those with 7, 8, 9,000 hours on the engines. And like
neither one of them use a full synthetic.
No.
You can't even put full synthetic in an L6. Because they don't make the full synthetic 2540.
No, they don't. And well, that's a whole different deal there, because that's a supercharged engine. Mm-hmm. So you're gonna have blow by because it's supercharged, whereas the other ones are all naturally aspirated.
Right.
So there is a little difference there on why you got to definitely have that thicker oil in the supercharged engine.
Explain the V10.
I can't.
I don't know.
That one's totally new, and there's no like.
That one's interesting. I am surprised to see that Mercury didn't just centralize it. Like, hey, everything uses 1030 now. You know what I mean? Like that would have been. That would have been the easiest thing ever. I think Suzuki's got it down.
Oh, dude! I mean, you got one oil, one choice,
Suzuki's
bro. It's like
got it down with that. Just here you go.
Yep. And it's good too. It's not like, you know, it's not like some kind of cheap.
It's you know, the bottle looks nice.
Yeah, it does.
That's my biggest tell is the bottle looks nice. Yamaha, it's like a 2-stroke jug. Just don't even use that stuff. I'd rather put water in my crankcase.
No, what about the Honda jug? Oh, for anybody listening to the podcast and not watching the video, I mean, facial expressions can say a lot.
No, there's no hate to Honda. Honda's just bland.
You know
what I mean? Like, I can accept Honda having a bland oil bottle because
it's a bland engine.
Yeah. It's a bland engine. Got nothing bad to say about its reliability.
No.
But it doesn't, you don't look at a Honda and go, wow, look at that engine. Look how cool.
Yeah, super fancy and like flashy. It's not like, you know, like Mercury trying to be like
same
all the
thing
colors.
With Yamaha, though. So who am I kidding? Oh, but their bottle ain't. I was just saying, see, there's a correlation here.
What about, well, Mercury bottles are pretty bland.
Bottles are bad. Those Quicksilver ones are bad. They're just plain.
Yeah.
Gray.
They're shiny. Yep. They got the shiny label.
Yeah. If you get the synthetic.
The Quicksilver, because the Mercury's a black bottle.
Yeah, Mercury's sleek. I like Mercury's. The black with the red.
Yeah.
Now, but back to the X-Star, the Suzuki one. I mean, they got it down with just having that centralized oil system. Like, Yamaha has so many different oils. It's not
Yamaha
funny.
Has? They only got 1030 and 2040.
What are you talking about? They've got 530.
That's 10, their full
1030.
Synthetic. Yep, and 2040.
1040.
That's it.
2040, and then...
No, there's a 1040?
There's a 1040.
Really?
But then if that's
only four...
Are
you sure about that? I don't know if my... I think Yamaha only has the 1030, the 2040, and the 530.
You're going to get called out on that.
Maybe I have. I mean...
You're going to get called out on that, dude.
I hope
so. Guarantee they make a 1040. Yeah, dude, 100%.
Look,
but even then, I only counted four.
Yeah. Well, and their TC... three or whatever, or the 2-stroke TM2 or TM3 TC3, whatever it is, their 2-stroke oil.
That doesn't count. We're talking about 4-strokes here, right?
Yeah, there's that's no, true.
There is synthetic 2-stroke oil though, because I swear I was looking up synthetic oil and I saw a jug of synthetic 2-stroke. I was like, who's using that? 2-strokes will burn anything.
Yeah, 10W40.
They have 1040, right? See, okay, I'm not.
Oh, come on, give me a break here.
No. Yeah, no brakes.
I can't think of all this stuff.
You've been doing this for too long to get brakes out of me. Mercury then also.
That's true.
Mercury has 1030, 2540, 2550, and that's it, right?
1030, 2540, 2550. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I'm pretty sure that's it.
And they don't even offer full synthetic, like I said, for two of those.
Mm-mm.
So it's like, I guess in an outboards stance, it's not really that important.
No, not the synthetic versus conventional. It's the weight that they are concerned about.
Generally.
Which goes back to, everything but the Yamaha. The Yamaha is its own thing. I mean, because they're like, you know, they...
No, even Mercury, dude. They say it too. They're like, if you don't have this, use this. If you don't have this, use this. And they just go down the list. They just say it less obviously than Yamaha. Yamaha will show you a group 1, group 2. you know, use group one. If you can't use group one, use group two. And it's mm-hmm. every oil everything. They have.
I guess if you break it down, you're pretty much left with put marine oil in the engine and the thing's going to run. And it's going to run for a long time.
Yeah. For anyone that you've got an option, I'd take the highest option. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like if I'm putting 2540 in something, I'm not doing the conventional. I'm doing the semi-synthetic.
Yeah.
Go with the highest option of what your manufacturer recommends and makes for that engine.
Yeah.
Because if Yamaha doesn't make a full synthetic, I wouldn't go buy Mercury 1030 full synthetic and put it in the Yamaha.
That's kind of a question that a lot of people want to ask too, is like, you know, what about Valvoline, Mobil 1, and these other...
No, don't use that.
I mean...
It has to be marine.
No. They make marine. Like, there are marine, like West Marine, Bass Pro, Valvoline, Shell, or not Shell, but yeah, the Rotella stuff. I mean, like, they all make a marine TCW oil.
Wow. I don't know that.
But I don't know. I mean, I've never...
I mean, that could probably also be... You know, there is inboards too.
Oh, yeah.
We forget to talk about those a lot.
Yeah.
But like an inboard, it's just a GM engine or, you know, whatever. But it's just a car engine.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Yeah, but they're stupid expensive. For me, it's a ridiculously expensive toy to have. You got this outboard, especially like, okay, you're talking about V12. It's a $100,000 outboard. And then, like, you know, even these 300s and 350s, I mean, you're talking about $30,000 outboards, $35,000. Mm-hmm. Even when you get down to the ones that are, you know, the 150s, you're still $10,000, $12,000, $15,000 for this engine. I mean, trying to save $10, $15 to me is a risk. I'm like, if I'm spending $15,000 on this engine, I'm going to spend $50 and get whatever brand, you know, is making, because all those four, you know, your top four, you know, you could throw in the Evinrude's whole totally different, because I would run Evinrude oil in that.
Evinrude,
like Tohatsu.
Does Evinrude make a four stroke?
They don't make a four stroke, they make two stroke, and I would use their XD100, XD50
two stroke oil.
Yeah, that oil. But like, dude, Yamaha's been around forever. They've been in the States since 1984. You know, Mercury's been around forever. Honda been around forever. Mm-hmm. Suzuki been around forever. So, I mean, they've got their oil. I would stick with that.
Yeah.
Just for a risk tolerance.
There's probably a reason there isn't a full synthetic recommended for all these engines. And it's because it just doesn't matter.
Yeah.
You know, they probably don't, they don't even have the life of like a car. When you get a car with age, people tell you to put synthetic in it.
Mm-hmm.
No, but people tell you all kinds of different things.
Did you? I think you can go on Google and look up whatever you want and get whatever answer you want. Like if you have a preconceived idea of, you know, whatever it may be. Maybe be this, you know, give me some example.
What do you mean some example? An example
like
of what?
Some of the stuff that we've been looking up. Like if you wanted it to be, you know, a certain weight or certain this, then you can Google and find that answer. Like, there's information.
Oh, well, yeah. Like, just if you Google anything about it, like even Googling how much synthetic oil is in a synthetic blend oil, some will tell you, like, no more than 30. And some are like, well, from 50 to 70%. It's like anywhere from 20 to 70. That's like, dude, what?
Anywhere from 0 to 100.
There's
no
consistency. All we know is, you know, tried, synthetic is better, but it's not necessary in an outboard unless recommended. Yeah. If you've got a V12, throw some synthetic in there. If you've got a VMAX, throw synthetic in there.
Mm-hmm.
Other than that, I think the general consensus is...
Put oil in that biscuit.
Put oil in the run. Manufacturer recommendation. Just go with that, and then, you know, if they give you a choice, then pick the highest one.
Yeah, yeah.
And that way... You'll have the longest, happiest life for your outboard. It won't matter anyway. I mean, how many outboards have you ever heard of breaking down because they were using conventional oil and not synthetic? It's,
yeah.
You know, if an outboard doesn't make it anymore, it's because it blew up.
Yeah.
I don't think.
I mean, I wouldn't go mixing. Like, I wouldn't take like a 530 and go mixing it with the 2550.
Does oil mix?
You start messing with the weights. I don't really know. I mean, to be honest with you, as a grease monkey, I bet you could take, you know, a little bit of all of them, put them all together and put it in there and you'd be all right. I mean, you know, to me, oil is going to be oil. Now, when you get down to the real physical aspects of it, you know, like R&D and engineers and all this stuff, like they've engineered the outboards to, you know, the engine to run the way they want it to run. Now, there might be some longevity effects of it, temperature, and, you know, this spot got oiled more than this spot, and now you got a heat spot, and now you, you know, wear out. But for general use, you could probably do that. But I wouldn't, I'd try and stay away from mixing the weights.
Mm-hmm. And thinking back on the car, like how cars were brought up with synthetic oils, you know, it makes sense to use synthetic in a car because you're using your car differently. You know, like everybody's using their car a different amount of distance, you know, every year. So like if you're, if you got to change it every year anyway, synthetic will tell you can go up to 10,000.
Yeah.
If you're putting 10,000 miles on your vehicle a year, then use the synthetic. You'd only have to change it once a year. Save yourself some money technically, right? If you're only putting 5,000 miles on it, then using conventional would probably be your best bet. And then to relate that into the outboard, you're changing it every 100 hours regardless. You know what I mean?
Well, now that's what, that's the interesting thing about that 600 is they're saying they're using that full synthetic and saying up to 200 hours.
They say up to 200 hours in general for that oil change. And then, but yeah, so then maybe if you were to, they say if you don't have synthetic, use blend or conventional.
Mm-hmm.
If you use conventional, is it a smart idea to go the 200 hours?
See, I don't know. I mean, and I don't have $100,000 to put that to some academical testing. No. You know, I mean, go out and, because I mean, I think that'd be fun. Just take it, take a, one of those engines and just put the conventional in there and let it run for 200 hours. And I mean, it'd be kind of interesting to take an engine, put oil in it, and then just let it run.
Yeah.
For until it blows up.
Let it run till it blows up.
Yeah.
What do you mean, in one go?
Yeah. Like, I mean, take an engine and then see how long you can run that on the oil until it blows up.
Yeah.
That'd
be have three different engines. You put $300,000 in $300,000 in V12s, and one of them gets conventional, one of them gets blend, and the other gets full synthetic. See which one goes first.
I mean, I gotta think that just the breakdown of the oil, you could probably get, you know, you got to be able to get a few hundred hours out of it. I mean, what is it, 500-600 hours before you think an engine would lock up based on the breakdown of the oil?
I don't know, man. I think it could be even more.
Really?
Dude, I've seen, like, have you ever seen those customer complaint videos?
Mm-hmm.
I've seen people just pulling, like, drain plugs and just seeing nothing but sludge, like mud.
Right.
Coming out of the engine. It's like, how long did they go without changing that oil?
That's what I'm
and
saying.
Just, if that thing is mud, I mean, there had to be more than 500 hours on that. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
In that oil.
Well, that's mileage. Like, you know, let's say that's 30,000 miles.
I'm saying more than 500 hours even. Like,
yeah.
Because there's, I mean, my truck has an hour counter, engine runtime.
That you can see it?
Yeah.
Like on the dash?
Yeah, yeah. 08 Silverado got the little driver information center. I tap on through. I think my truck's got like 3,400 hours or something on it.
Oh, wow.
More reliable than any Yamaha I've ever known. Just kidding.
Now, I don't know about that because, so,
funny enough, with my truck, I do have a bad oil pan gasket, and the thing was leaking real bad with synthetic. So I went to a synthetic blend.
Yeah.
And the leak slowed down. Like,
you also been putting stop leak in there too, right?
I did that with the synthetic too, and it didn't.
Really?
So you're running
a semi-synthetic, not a conventional?
Yeah. Yeah, I wouldn't run. I don't like, I don't know. I wouldn't run conventional in anything unless it's all there is, like in Yamaha. You know, they recommend you use the Yamaha oil 1030.
Right.
If it's conventional, it's conventional. Yamaha's telling you. And in an outboard sense, I use the specific brands. But like, since in the automotive, there's all those different brands predominantly. Like Chevy isn't making oil.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So you have to look for like Mobil 1 or
Valvoline
or whatever you want. I'm using
not
conventional.
Now, Ed, how many miles are on that truck?
193,000.
So 193,000, and you said there's 3,000.
I couldn't tell you the exact estimate. I think there's 3,400 hours on it.
That's interesting.
I think there's 3,400. There is a lot of idle hours on that. Too many idle hours on that truck.
So let's say that at 3,500 hours, you're running 200,000 miles.
Mm-hmm.
So that means that these outboards, like, you know, the ones that have 9,000 hours, you know, let's say an outboard makes 7,000 hours.
Mm-hmm.
So that's equivalent to running 400,000 miles.
Not necessarily. Think about it on boats. You're running straight line miles.
True.
In cars, you're zigzagging. Out on the ocean, there's no lights and turns. You just go.
Also, the idle time. So your clock's ticking. Maybe you're sitting in the truck, you know, not moving, not gaining on this mile. So
that's what I'm saying. Like I have that truck has a lot of idle miles or hours anyway.
So that's probably why you can't, there isn't like a mathematical equivalent of hours to mileage. You know, like people want to come into the boating world and look at like, you know, what's the equivalent to 150,000 miles on an outboard engine? And there's no like relative, you know, mathematical equation for that. I mean, I guess you could generalize it like I just did with, you know, 3,500 hours and 200,000 miles. Mm-hmm. So
there's no good conversion for that.
There is no conversion because if, you know, what about highway miles? You know, someone that puts on nothing but highway miles and they're just running all the time. The clock's not ticking as much, but they're just banking those miles.
Mm-hmm. No, there's no good conversion. That's why it's hard to talk about the difference between outboards and cars because of that miles versus hours.
Yeah.
There's no comparison to that. But anyway, I think we've been rambling a whole lot about this topic. So.
Oh, yeah. What was the original question?
I don't even think it was a question. I think Doug asked just in general, like talk about synthetic oils, the good, the bad, the ugly. For outboard use.
I think we talked about the good for the synthetic.
Maybe he's asking because there's synthetics starting to pop up. Because I said Mercury doesn't make a synthetic 2540, but I could have sworn.
What? They make a 2540? That is a synthetic.
It's a synthetic blend.
Yeah. Not a full, you're saying a full synthetic.
That's what I'm saying. Yeah, yeah. A full synthetic 2540. I said they don't make it, but they might have just released it. Because I was looking through the Land and Sea book, and I thought I saw a full synthetic 2540, but maybe synthetics are starting to come about more prevalently in the marine industry with these coming years and with the modernization of outboards.
Yeah.
Like a V12, I wouldn't want to put anything other than full synthetic in there because it's just such a machine. Like, it's
$100,000.
Yeah, it's you'd want the best possible lubrication and heat capabilities and all that stuff. So,
well, I think they've got it dialed in for that exact thing. I mean, I would go with the full synthetic.
Yeah. Anyway, thank you, Doug, for bringing that up. Now, Steve, we speaking of oil and all this stuff, servicing, we had that video on servicing that L6.
Mm-hmm.
There's a couple questions there. And we had Steve who asked about the cost of a service because he's about to get his 300 Verado serviced. And really I guess that all depends on your location. It all depends on where exactly you're at because it's all on the labor rate.
Oh, yeah.
You know?
I want to say for most of those, you're anywhere from like $900 to $1,200 bucks for a full service per engine. Isn't that sound about right?
I want to say at least, yeah. Just about that. Pretty much you're paying for all the parts.
Yeah.
And then.
So you got like.
And then the services are just flat rate.
Yeah.
Every time. Like, you know, what do you charge for 100 hour? 2 hours?
Yeah. Two and a half.
So two and a half hours for 100-hour service at whatever the labor rate is. A full service, you're charging 4 hours.
Yep.
And it's, like I said, it depends on where you're at. Like in the Keys, the labor rate is 185. Stupid. It might even be more now.
Yeah, it might be 200 by now.
It's bad. Yeah. Whereas here, what's a shop rate? 135?
Yeah, 120, 135, somewhere around there.
Yeah, it's, you know, it'd be a lot cheaper to get your engine serviced here than down there.
Yep.
Yeah, I'd say you can just go to parts view and put together a list of all the parts that you need for the full service.
Yep.
And then just add that with 4 hours at whatever your local shop rate is.
Yeah.
And that'll be the cost of a full service for your particular engine. But really, yeah, services are, as far as the mechanic's concerned, services are like the best way to make money. Because of that flat rate, you know.
Well, it's, you can get good at it.
Exactly. We talked about flat rate before and how the better tech shouldn't be punished just because he's quicker. And services are the biggest example of that.
Right.
You know, you're charging 4 hours for a full service, and it might take the average tech four hours or more. Could take them more.
Well, you could always have other issues like broken bolts, seized bolts, stuff like that. So
sure, but depending on those issues, I guess you'd start breaking away from it being the flat rate.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you're, you know, if you quote somebody, hey, it's going to be 4 hours for this service, and then their lower unit's seized up in there, and you got to start chipping this thing out, and it's like that's, you know, it's not my fault.
Yeah.
That you didn't get your engine serviced earlier, and now this lower unit's stuck up here. Like,
well, we also just had that same thing with the water separators. How that yellowfin? How old was that boat? You went and surveyed that, right?
Yeah, quickly, like just briefly. The guy had already bought it, I think, but he wanted it checked out, see what he had to straighten out, and
that was like a 2020, I think, somewhere 2021 yellowfin.
Yep.
So it's only 2 years old. And no one changed the water separators, and they were so rusted on already.
Trying to loosen them would
we couldn't get them off.
Yeah,
and so I had to get down in the bilge in order to get, you know, get my hand on it to get leverage to be able to break that thing free. So
without pulling the head,
the head off of the stringer. So think about how much time that would have added if, you know, like I wasn't able to get down there. Because if you were doing it, you couldn't get down there. You would have been like, reach your hand down there and pull it. And I, because that was when I started, that's what I tried to do. I tried to break it, and I could hear it. It was like,
no, you hear it like it's about to rip that screw right out, and you're like, okay.
So I'd climb down in there and, you know, get, you know, positioned and hold it and crank it out to break it free.
Even
but
then, I've had filters so stuck that, like, even if the bilge is bigger and I can get in there and put some leverage on there, like, sometimes they are so rusted on there.
Yeah, you've got to take the whole bracket off.
You're ripping it off. Take it to a vise.
Yep. Cut the hoses and bring it off and
take it to a vise and take it off.
Cause
it's better than tearing it out of the stringer.
Yeah. The price of a service, you're pretty much,
that 4 hours is dependent on everything being, you know, normal with your engine. Like if it's just a regular routine maintenance, and there's no glaring obvious issues, everything goes smoothly, the service was 4 hours.
Yep.
Whether it took eight, whether it took two.
Yep.
You know?
It's definitely going to vary by where you're at based on that labor. So there's your numbers. So kind of call a shop around where you're at, see how much the labor rate is, and then calculate on annual service, which is no impeller, no thermostats. And you're looking at two and a half hours, or full service with thermostats, anodes, all that stuff, and you're looking at 4 hours. And then add that to, like you said, go to parts view or something like that. I think in general, 100-hour service, depending on the horsepower, if you've got a 90 horse, it's going to be way different than a 350. But based on those, for most of your small engines, you're looking, you know.
That's true. I never did pay attention to, you know, being at the marina, how long a service would be charged for like something small like that.
Yeah, I can't even.
Because the time is considerably different.
Oh, yeah. No, it definitely is. I didn't. For the most part, even horsepower range doesn't matter. Most of it, it's, you know, 2, 2.5, and 4. That's pretty much your
time. For this guy's particular case, too, he said he had a 300 Verado.
Yeah.
I think
you're,
so, yeah.
You're probably around 1,000, 12.
Yeah.
Depending, mm-hmm. somewhere around there.
Probably around that, 1,000, 1,200 bucks.
Mm-hmm.
And continuing on, we got a question from Fox Lynx, and he said, well, he said, we should have shown draining the oil and gone a little more in depth, changing the impeller. But I'm pretty sure we have, there's like dedicated videos on changing the impeller.
Oh yeah. Yeah. We've got dedicated videos on doing services.
For the L6, they do have the drain plug that you just replace the,
mm-hmm.
the gasket on, but we don't have the gaskets. We have an oil sucker, and for most engines, like Yamaha's, you're sucking the oil out anyway.
I mean, well, Yamaha's have drains too. I mean, for me, I'm a fan of doing the drains. Like, mm-hmm. I like doing the drains because it's quicker.
Yeah.
You know, other people like to suck it out, which takes longer. So I guess it's all opinion. Like, it also, there's the, taking the drain out, you've got the variable of who's been working on the engine, because there's, we've seen quite a few engines where, you know, some mechanic has been in there with, you know, his half inch breaker bar tightening the drain bolt, or the impact, half inch impact, just send the drain bolt, and then now
strip it right out,
stripped, cross threaded, and now you're doing helicoils. So, you know, I'm a fan of draining it, because especially doing anything, twins, trips, quads.
Yeah, you're not carrying around 4 oil suckers, and it takes
that much longer. Whereas you can go there, especially on Verados, and use the oil filter thing, put some painter's tape, make a funnel, put all 4 buckets, crack those things out, and then boom, in 8 minutes, you got all 4 engines fully drained. Mm-hmm. And in that amount of time, you can be changing out your oil filters, changing out your fuel filters, and all that stuff. So then by the time... That's kind of
a quad service can actually be done
pretty quickly,
incredibly fast if you're prepared and you know what you're doing.
Yep.
Especially on those L6s or anything with drain plugs, because you could be draining the lower units and the engine oil
mm-hmm.
same time. Have your 3 drain pans, your 3 buckets right next mm-hmm. to each other, and as those are draining, boom, 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 quickly replace everything up top.
Yep.
Spark plugs are going to take you a little bit, but that's sheer numbers.
I mean, that's kind of my. That's my routine right there mm-hmm. is go there, put the drain pans, put the oils, get the oil draining. And once the oil's draining, I take the props off, get the lower units draining. And then once all those are draining, because the lower units take a little bit longer to drain than the engine oil. But while those are all draining, I'll go up, change the water separators, because those are the variable there. I always try and do the variable stuff first. So if there's like a chance, I like to do the hard thing or the variable first. So that way, in the event of, oh, this water separator don't come off, or, you know, you can't get to it, this, that, and anything, you got time to handle whatever you got to handle, mm-hmm. and then boom, attack the engine, thermostats, all that stuff, because that stuff's all easy. And then, you know, you got an easy day after that, because now it's just change out them thermostats, trim them up, pull the lowers, change the anodes, change the impellers, throw them up, done.
Yeah, no, it's especially considering how much it's technically you're being charged for that. If you're doing a quad service, it's still the same. It applies for each one. It's 4 hours.
Oh yeah.
A motor. You know what I mean? Doesn't matter whether you got 1 or 4 or 6.
Mm-hmm.
It's 4 hours a motor, but you can get that quad service done.
Yeah. In a day, easy.
Yeah.
Yeah. Easy. With no, you know, hiccups, but
way less than 12 hours.
Yeah. Way less than 16 hours.
Jeez. Yeah. Where's my math?
But, you know, I've also seen people that don't, you know, if this is like your 4th or 5th service, you still don't have that process down yet where you're, you know, mm-hmm. you're in the flow of things and you've got it, you know, got it going on. So, you know,
No,
it takes practice.
I've watched a quad service roll into the next day. Plenty of times mm-hmm. early on when I started in the marina, I think with Jack's boat,
mm-hmm.
just cause, or no, it wasn't Jack's boat. There was a quad with L6s, and here's where we can shift into Arno's question, where we should have shown the shift shaft disconnect and connecting procedure in that.
Oh, yeah.
And I'll never forget my first time dropping an L6 lower unit and trying to put it back up. It was a nightmare. It really? Was terrible because, well, Arno, to answer your question for disconnecting it, it's just as simple as letting it drop. Like, yeah. it's just splines that go into a receiver, like a little coupler.
Mm-hmm.
So there's no, like, I know on some smaller engines, you have to undo two nuts. And
yeah, those are all, like, 9.5 below. I mean, most of the, well, even, I think there's a couple 20s at 15s, but.
But that L6, yeah, disconnecting, simple. It's just like a Yamaha, you know, drop it. Mm-hmm. There's splines. But unlike the Yamaha, where, I don't know, I guess the Yamaha one sticks down lower.
Depends, because those 30-inchers, you got the long shaft and the spacer, so there's...
That's just good luck with whatever you got going
and
on.
And that one, they got the prongs that come down, so you can't spin the lower to pop it up. So there's some variable spacers, there, too.
Let's just talk about, like, a 25-inch base motor. Like, yeah. No spacer, because spacers are always a... pain in the butt.
And just for anybody that doesn't know what we're talking about with the spacers is, you know, outboards come based on the transom of your boat, because, you know, you got bay boats which only have this big of a transom, and then you got center consoles which got a bigger transom. So your outboard will come in like a 15, 20, 25, 30 or 35 inch shaft length, which means it's either, you know, the lower unit is, you know, drive shaft is 15, 20, 25, 30, you know, it has a variable there to, you know, account for the distance on the back of the boat, the transom. And then for these other ones, they put spacers to get that distance.
Yeah, and sometimes the spacer doesn't stay up.
Yeah.
If you're trying to throw a lower unit up and the spacer keeps falling.
Yep.
You know, I haven't had to run into that in a long time, thank God. But,
mm-hmm.
But yeah, it can be a pain in the neck with those L6s especially, because unlike the Yamaha, where, let's say, in a standard no spacer, I've never had an issue lining up the shift shaft. Like, yeah. Like, the thing sticks, the coupler, I guess, sticks down far enough. In the
on
Yamaha.
Most of them. Some of them that's got the long shaft on the lower.
What do you mean? Which one?
Some of the lowers on the 30s have a long shift shaft that sticks up in the spacer.
You're saying base, no.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, sorry.
Come on, dude. Stop throwing spacers in here. But, yeah, it's easier with the Yamaha. Because all you have to do is just, like, really stick a finger in there and kind of pull it, pop it in, and it, every time I've done it, it just lines right up. It goes right up in there, mm-hmm. And it's, like, no problem.
Right.
But the L6, you can't just stick your finger up and move it or grab it. I think on the 350s and 400s, they exposed the shaft,
mm-hmm.
Out, like, in front of the chaps.
So you can reach it.
So that you can reach it and at least, like, try to wiggle it and play the guessing game. But if you really want to get at it, like and know with 100% certainty that you'll get it, you have to take those side chaps off.
Yep.
So that you can, like, visibly see what, you know, the splines lining up. So you can see it going up and down into it, because those splines move all the time in the lower mm-hmm. unit too. And then I've had plenty of times where I'll, boom, it pops up and it's in place. And I'm like, oh, wow. That was pretty quick. And then I turn the prop shaft and it's in gear. It's like, oh, man.
Yep, got
it. Drop it again and send it back up. And, oh, it moved again. And just, you can get stuck in that cycle. As mm-hmm. The more you do,
yeah,
you know, the quicker you get.
Yeah.
And then eventually you just start preemptively taking the chaps off. Like just before I even try it, yep. I'm taking the chaps off. I'm going to save myself the headache. I'm going to get it with 100% certainty. Boom. And then send it. And what does help with the Verados is you can grab that shaft and move it up and down.
Mm-hmm. To let you know if you got it.
Yeah. So you could, like, move it up and out of the way and then turn it a little bit and boom. Now, you don't want to turn the shaft itself in the midsection.
Yeah, especially with the key on.
Yeah, because then that'll bind up the shift actuator mm-hmm. and... You got a whole nother issue on your hands.
Yeah. Well, I mean, what I do is I just put the nuts on there, and then I just put it up there, and then I just tighten the nuts until it goes all the way up.
Right.
No, I'm just kidding. Do not do that. Do not do that.
I was going to say, go ahead. Go ahead. Try it out. See. And you know what? Don't even check to see if it shifts because you're so confident that you should throw that thing in the water and go.
Right? Oh, yeah. Don't do that. I mean, there's a lot of people that will do that. Like, you know, in the two-stroke days, stuff like that. And I mean, there are some where you can kind of line up, do it, but don't.
Dude, I watch somebody.
Don't do that.
No, I watched somebody on a triple service throw three of them. Boom, boom, boom. All three of them up there and just did that.
Really?
Didn't go verify, you know. Like, it felt like it was in neutral, right?
Oh, man.
But they missed the shaft altogether. And then I think on
one of them. They're lucky they didn't hit the shaft and then drive the shaft up.
I think on one of them they drove it up and then that, what is it?
Break the collar?
The little collar, but there's like.
That holds the shift shaft in place?
Yeah, like that just. Yep. Isn't that a power head?
Some of them will. Some of the shift shafts, you can drive it up and hit it into the crankcase, yeah.
No, I mean like. Like if that, there's like a bushing or something in there too that'll get stuck.
Mm-hmm.
If it's not, and then you have to.
Oh yeah, you got to pull the power head to realign it to fix it.
So I think that had to be done. They, on all three of them, they missed the shift shaft, and on the one of them they hit the bottom portion of that coupler.
Yep.
That's flat
and drove it up.
So
bad.
Yeah, you gotta know what you're doing, I guess, but
yeah.
There's no better way to find out than doing it.
Yep.
And I guarantee that person will never do that again.
No.
Never, ever, ever again.
Yeah. Sometimes you gotta force stuff, but other times you don't.
It is tough when it's like really old, and sometimes you have those splines lined up and you're in neutral, and then there's that tiny little bit left that is not going up. And it's like, okay, I could put the nut on and just force it up, but
no, bad idea.
What if it's, you know, what if something's just not right? And
well, that's, I mean, you can turn the shift shaft a little bit, like keys off. You can turn the shift shaft a little bit. You'll hear the actuator move, but you know, you can kind of line it up, or you know, you can put it into gear. But same thing, even if you go up, turn the keys on, put it in reverse, and when it turns over, put the lower unit in reverse and still try and get up, but. Sometimes, again, they don't.
There's a pretty wide range of it being in gear.
Like yeah.
You still have to line those splines up.
Yep. Yeah. You still gotta, you know, get in there and kind of move it around and try and line it up. And then you know you got it or not. Like, you can put it up, put a nut on it to hold it there. You don't use the nut to drive it up. But then you can kind of grab the shift shaft and spin it around and feel the hole and then, like, stick it down in. And then when it drops down in, you just grab it and move it up and down. And if it goes up and down, you made it.
Yeah. I'll tell you what, there's nothing more satisfying in boating than throwing up an L6 lower unit first try and feeling it.
Yeah.
You're like, you know that feeling when you get it first try. It just, beep, it just falls right in. You're like, oh.
Yeah, there is no really better feeling than getting it up there, especially like when you got more than one. Say you're struggling on one and the other one just goes right up. You're like, you feel real good.
Yeah. It gets you excited, and you're like, all right, I can go back to this other one and keep try it again. But anyway, I think that about answers it for Arno.
Mm-hmm.
Next, Eli asked an interesting question because I'd never really thought of this, but how often should you run a fuel additive? And actually, I was looking in the, I can't remember if it was service manual or owner's manual, but I think Mercury recommends that every year, like either annually or every 100 hours, you run quick clean in your fuel tank. So,
yeah.
So I guess technically it's a service item that no one does.
I mean, there are people that do it. I would run it every fill up.
I mean, what is a bottle of quick clean?
Well, quick clean, especially quick clean, because quick clean is like $10 a bottle.
And it's not like is there a certain formula in there with quick clean? Or
yeah, it's just like 1 ounce does 5 gallons. So out of a 12 ounce bottle, you get 60 gallons.
Okay. But
so it's not bad. Now, ring free, which is amazing, is super expensive. So, but we used to run ring free.
What's super expensive?
It's like $50-$60 a bottle.
Really? I thought I saw $22 for a
bottle of ring free.
Maybe the small bottle. but it's so concentrated that I don't know, man. Yeah, I didn't think it was like, I think there's two different size bottles, but there it's is. Super.
There's the 12 ounce in the quart.
Right. But it's super concentrated. So getting the 12 ounce for most people is probably enough. Well,
the 12 ounce bottle is, yeah, ring free plus.
Mm-hmm. How much? Tell me.
Well, $20.
I'm here. $20.
Wow. That
is. And I'm good. I definitely didn't search that up at any point today.
Now, how many 1 ounce of ring free for every 10 gallons? So maybe ring free isn't as expensive as it was. So, I mean, if you got a 12 ounce bottle and 12 ounces will do 120 gallons.
Mm-hmm.
I mean,
now ring free and quick clean, do they accomplish the same thing? They're just like Yamaha and Mercury's version of a carbon cleaner.
Pretty much.
Okay.
Yeah. We used to run ring free in every fill up when there were the like Yamahas. And then Mercury, same thing. We'd run
quickly. What do you mean we'd run like?
Like in my boats.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
But yeah, that was interesting to find out, back to the fuel additive.
Yeah.
That it is considered a service item. Like you're supposed to do it every 100 hours.
I mean, seeing that the ring free is only $20, I mean, I'd put that in for 120 gallons.
Yeah, I don't
10 ounces
that.
To the gallon or the ounce. So, I mean, 10 gallons to the ounce. I would run ring free or quick clean.
Yeah, you're throwing a few $100 at the engine for the service anyway.
Dude, the stuff works. Like it really works. Mm-hmm. Like if you see an engine that's got 1,000 hours that ran quick clean compared to an engine that's got 1,000 hours that did not run it, I mean, it's a huge difference when you look in the cylinder and see the carbon build up.
Mm-hmm.
And then to get that carbon off, that's a whole nother process. And the best thing to do for that carbon is, A, you got to take the whole engine apart and clean all the parts, like physically clean them.
Mm-hmm.
Or, you know, if you get lucky, you can use Yik, but, you know, only dealers can get that, which is Yamaha internal engine cleaner. And that stuff's like super potent. Like it's
got to run it in a separate fuel tank kind of deal.
Yeah. You basically take like a 6 gallon tank, 3 gallon tank, and then mix the Yik in with fuel at a certain percentage. And then you run the engine on that tank till the tank is done.
Right.
And then after that, you can run back with ring free and, you know, clean it all out. So it's a whole process to try and decarbon an engine where like, so at 120 gallons per bottle, trying to think, it depends on how much your fuel economy is. So over 1,000 hours, what you're going to be looking at if you were to run it every fill up.
If you're running it every fill up over the course of 1,000 hours?
Yeah.
Like, what are you asking? Like how much it would cost?
Yeah, I was just trying to do the math on how much that would cost if you ran...
Negligible. It doesn't matter.
Yeah.
If you're doing it with every service, or are you saying with every fill-up?
Yeah, every fill-up. So let's say your fuel tank's 100 gallons.
Mm-hmm.
You run, 100 gallons at $4 a gallon is going to be $400. And right now, I mean, what is gas 100
gallons at four? I was going to say, why are you throwing out four? Like, that's cheap, dude.
How much is Rec 90 right now?
Up here, I have no idea, but at Shelter Bay,
it was I think the last it was like five.
No, it was like 560 something. I think it changes. I think it touched $6. I don't know what it is currently, I guess, because we're not there anymore. But it's still got to be around that, around 550.
All right. Well, even at $5 a gallon, it's $500 for the fill up. So at $500, you add $20 on that.
Yeah, there's. No
reason. He says it's negligible.
No reason to cry about $20, especially when it's going to just do nothing but help you in the long run.
Mm-hmm.
How long does the process of decarboning an engine fully take?
A couple hours.
A few hours? Okay. Well, now another question I have too is is there a way to accelerate or decelerate carbon buildup without using any fuel additives? I'm pretty sure... Like, idling all the time is bad, and it causes more
right
carbon buildup.
So is trolling.
Right.
Slow speed trolling.
So how much carbon buildup would you have? Like if you're just running and gunning, you're wide open throttle all the time.
Mm-hmm.
Is it worth running quick clean in your engine, or are you really just kind of burning all that stuff out anyway?
For the most part, you're burning all out, but it's not like, you know, it's not like the short hours. It's the long hours. So like if you've got, you know, even if you're running wide open throttle, I mean, 2,000, 3,000, 4,000 hours on the engine, mm-hmm. you're going to have carbon. Like there's no...
Right. Yeah, there will be.
There is no... So that's our alarm. I put it on for over an hour. So I think what we're going to have to do is cut this one and then just start back in on the next one just so we can kind of get this one time-wise down. But we can finish this conversation out. So like carbon... I mean, at 3,000 hours, you're going to have carbon buildup no matter what. Doesn't matter. Like, carbon's just a byproduct of
right. But you'll have gas. More carbon buildup in something that idled
100%
for a long time or yeah. trolled yep. than something that was ran hard mm-hmm. its whole life.
Yeah, because when you're running hard, you're like, you know, you're blowing all that stuff out the exhaust. Like, you're, you know, you're.
So I guess, you know, to answer how often. Maybe I guess it just depends on how you run your boat.
Yeah.
If you're running...
If you're idle trolling a lot, then...
Every fill up. Probably.
For 20 bucks? For 10 mm-hmm. bucks?
Yeah, every fill up. Now, if you're just, you know, running your boat like normal, I guess, or how it's intended,
mm-hmm.
Then do it...
Every 100 hours.
Every 100 hours.
Yep.
Which is interesting. I'm going to start throwing that into the services because
mm-hmm.
I'd never
thought about it.
I'd never even read that. I mean, like,
yeah, I didn't either. I didn't know that that on the service intervals.
Yeah. I guess I just always gloss over it. You know, I never really mm-hmm. go quickly. And, you know, who's using that? You know, like whatever, but I don't know. It's
good stuff.
It's
man.
Interesting. You know, for 20 bucks, why not?
Mm-hmm.
Why not throw it in there?
I definitely would.
We've run out of time here on yep. this one. So I guess that'll wrap up this episode. Hope we got some kind of answers out there for you guys that might mm-hmm. might have been useful. And we will see you on the next one.
Yeah. Drop some comments below. Email us.
That's
askbab@borningandboating.com. And we'll try and answer everybody's questions.